the t-shirts.
You got them?
Yes. So we have a ministry team meeting on Tuesday night. So I'm going to give them order forms and show them the shirts. And then they can take it out to the church. I mean, it'll still be something in the bulletin. But I thought that would be a good way to get it out there.
Yeah.
you would turn in your bulletin so we can review our announcements. If you'd like some more information, more detailed information about how to access our worship services online, there is information there. For Matthew, if you have any other questions, I'm sure that he'd be happy to answer them for you. Coming up on September 7th, our plans changed somewhat. We weren't able to get tickets to the play, but we are still going for lunch and some shopping. If you'd like to go, I'd like to know the next couple of days or so we can arrange for rides. Next Sunday, we'll be going to Shepherd's Heart as Episcopalian Church down near the Consol Energy Center. We'll be worshiping with the folks there, as well as serving a meal. We'll be leaving somewhere between 2 and 2:30. Again, if you would let me know if we'd be able to go. The next information there about Oak Ridge is for their church, so you can disregard that. But following that, on Sunday, September 11th, 2 weeks from today, there'll be a concert at Leisure Run at 2 o'clock by Isaac Cole of the Cable Inn. They're from the Ellison area and have become quite well known. Plan to be there. On the calendar, Bible study tomorrow night here, Wednesday night at Oak Ridge. The ministry team meeting for the co-op is Tuesday night here at First Church at 7 o'clock. I think we've covered about any on Wednesday evening. Our schedule resumes for the fall. Christian Head will meet at 6:15, followed by the first choir practice. On Thursday evening will be a finance meeting at 6:15, followed by church. Youth will meet next week in the United Methodist Women on September 8th. There's a collection of non-perishable canned goods taking place at the Clarion Mall for the month of September. If you'd like to participate in that, the information is there. Do you have any other announcements this morning?
Crafts will be this week, Tuesday night at 6 o'clock, or Thursday night at 6 o'clock, and either or.
Perhaps for the bazaar Tuesday and for Thursday evenings this week at 6 o'clock. Any other announcements? All right, then if there aren't any, let's take a few minutes and pass a few supplies.
Thank you.
Come bless the Lord who guides us, whose wise teaching directs our days and focuses our minds at night, whose presence sustains us and surrounds us here.
We bless the Lord who is present among us. He will not be shaken nor live in fear, but will sing God's praise and worship with joy.
Our first hymn this morning is on page 185.
Thank you.
We continue now on our worship with the giving of our tithes and offerings.
Yeah.
And for their parents as well. Any birthdays this week? Or last week? We missed a week here. Other prayer concerns, though?
I'd say the first birthday.
Emma Anderson. Family of Cecilia Rupert.
Family of Daniel Fritz.
Fritz. And of course, the Chandler family. Others.
Robert Nicewanger.
Family of Wayne Boozer.
Very disappointed in the Noble Borley family because he passed away.
In the Borley family?
His wife did. His wife.
All right, Borley family.
Cindy Morgan
will be having surgery on Tuesday. List from Sunday School, Aaron and Wade Bish, Sheila and Dick Trout, Paul Wheeler, Cheryl Ann and John Kellerman, Terry Rankin, The Election, Our Country, The Shootings, Emily Taggio, Mary Jane, and Amy Hodge and family. Do you have any others to add to the list today?
Please continue to keep Bob Schaefer. Yesterday was 3 months since his accident. He's still not able to communicate and speak yet, but he is making tiny bits of progress.
God, as we come into your sanctuary this morning, we pray that we may not be here just out of routine. This might not just be something that we always do on Sunday morning. May it truly be a time where we can come and worship you. And Lord, part of our worship is certainly being a witness and sharing all the ways that you're at work in our lives and all the blessings that you give to us and the ways that you answer our prayers. And we are praying, Lord, that you would continue to be with those that we have lifted up, that you would bless them in all ways that they are needed. We pray, God, for those who are in need of your healing touch. We pray for those families, the Rupert family and the Fritz family, Chandler family, the Boozer family, and the Borley family. There are so many who are hurting today in the loss of a loved one. We just lift them up to you and pray, God, that you would give them the comfort that they need in this time of sadness and separation. We thank you, God, for your protection. It's something that we so often take for granted, but we're thankful that Luke was not hurt any worse this week. And we thank you, God, for the mysterious ways that you move. Keep us safe. And we just thank you, God, that we are able to be here this morning. And without fear of persecution, as so many who are worshiping in different parts of the world are experiencing today. God, we pray for Cindy as she has her surgery this week. We pray that all might go well and the healing might come through the surgeon's hands. But we continue to pray for Frog Schaefer, who's had a very long and difficult journey since his accident. And we know how frustrating that can be and how impatient we can grow. And we just pray that you would be with him, that he would have the encouragement and the hope that he needs to meet the challenges of every day. God, we pray for Rob Nicewanger and just pray, God, that you would be at work in his life and that you would tear down all those barriers that have been placed between yourself and him, whether physical or emotional. We pray for him, Lord, and we pray for his safety. We pray, Lord, that you would work in his life. We pray for this man, Lord. During these very difficult and somewhat frightening days. Well, we are missing our college students this morning, and we pray that you'd be with them as they begin this new chapter in their lives. We pray, Lord, that they would be reminded that we are certainly thinking of them and that wherever they might find themselves, that you are there with them. Well, we place all these prayers before you, praying that as your people, and we may bring you glory in all that we do. We thank you for all the ways that you bless us. And we pray, God, that we might go from this place being a blessing to other people in the coming week. Lord, we pray for our country, we pray for our world, we pray for wisdom in this time of election. We pray for all of those, Lord, who have been named. We pray for those who are on our prayer list. God, we place all of these into your tender, loving arms, praying that all things might work according to your perfect will. And now, God, we come together as your church, praying as Jesus taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We continue this morning in our sermon series on Abraham. And today we are in Genesis chapter 1, the first 21 verses. So let us concentrate this morning and hear God's word for us today. Now the Lord was gracious to Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah what he had promised. Sarah became pregnant and bore a son to Abraham in his old age at the very time God had promised him. Abraham gave the name Isaac to the son Sarah bore him. When his son Isaac was 8 days old, Abraham circumcised him as God commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Sarah said, God has brought me laughter, and everyone who hears about this will laugh with me. And she added, who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age. The child grew and was weaned, and on the day Isaac was weaned, Abraham held a great feast. But Sarah saw that the son whom Hagar the Egyptian had borne to Abraham was mocking. And she said to Abraham, get rid of that slave woman and her son, for that woman's son will never share in the inheritance with my son Isaac. The matter distressed Abraham greatly because it concerned his son. But God said to him, do not be so distressed about the boy and your slave woman. Listen to whatever Sarah tells you, because it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. I will make the son of the slave into a nation also, because he is your offspring. Early the next morning, Abraham took some food and a skin of water and gave them to Hagar. He set them on her shoulders and then set off with the boy. She went on her way and wandered in the desert of Beersheba. When the water and the skin was gone, she put the boy under one of the bushes. Then she went off and sat down about a bow shot away, for she thought, I cannot watch the boy die. And as she sat there, she began to sob. God heard the boy crying, and the angel of the Lord called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, what is the matter, Hagar? Do not be afraid. God has heard the boy crying as he lies there. Lift the boy up and take him by the hand, for I will make him into a great nation. Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. So she went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy. God was with the boy as he grew up. He lived in the desert and became an archer. While he was living in the desert of Paran, his mother got a wife for him from Egypt. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. You would pray with me. God, as we continue to study the life of Abraham, we pray that you might teach us. That you might teach us what it is to have faith. what it is to trust. We pray, God, for your Holy Spirit to dwell among us. We pray, God, that the meditation of our hearts and the words of my mouth will be acceptable to you. Amen. Just in the way of a short review, we are reminded that we began talking about Abraham by learning of God's call upon his life to go. To leave everything that he knew as familiar, his country, his family, his home, and go to a new land that God promised. God made a covenant with Abraham. He took him out and had a look up at the night sky and said, as many stars as you see in that sky, you will have that many descendants. But Abraham and Sarah had their doubts. And what we haven't talked about yet is that Abraham and Sarah decided to take matters into their own hands. They decided they couldn't trust God to do what God said he would do. So Sarah devised a plan. She would give her slave girl Hagar to Abraham as a wife. Now, as we continue to talk about this, remember that this was Sarah's idea. And so Hagar becomes Abraham's wife, and not too long afterwards, she becomes pregnant, which was the idea behind the plan. And Scripture tells us that Hagar looked on Sarah with contempt. We can imagine what that might mean. We could guess that Hagar thought she was queen of the tent. She had what Sarah so desperately wanted. And she probably did not let a day go by that she didn't allow and not remind Sarah that she was going to have a baby. And Sarah did. Sarah didn't like this one bit. Maybe by now she's realizing her mistake, so she complains to Abraham. And Abraham tells her to do whatever she wants with Hagar. The Scripture tells us that Sarah dealt harshly with Hagar. And again, you can only imagine what that means. But it must have been unbearable for Hagar because she runs away. An angel of the Lord meets her in the desert and tells her to go back, that she will have a son, and that she's to name him Ishmael. Well, despite all of Abraham and Sarah's meddling, God keeps God's promise. And Sarah did get pregnant in her old age. She had a son. She named him Isaac, which means he laughs. And Sarah now laughs with joy instead of disbelief. What seems impossible has happened. And Isaac is just the beginning of the countless descendants that God promised to Abraham. It was a tradition in the Jewish faith to have a celebration when a child was weaned when they were about 3 years old. And so it's a celebration for Isaac. Sarah sees Ishmael, who would be somewhere around 14 years of age, playing with Isaac. Scripture says that Ishmael was mocking Isaac. And Sarah doesn't like this either. And she doesn't want Ishmael to inherit Abraham's fortune. She wanted that for Isaac and Isaac alone. And so she goes to Abraham again and talks to him about this, and he understands her concerns. It was also a tradition that the oldest child would inherit the bulk of the father's estate. Now Abraham hesitates because Ishmael is his son after all. But he sends Hagar and Ishmael away. With barely enough food and water to survive. God tells Abraham not to worry, he's doing the right thing, and that he would make a great nation of Ishmael as well. But he also tells him that his promise would be fulfilled through Isaac, the child that was promised. The truth is, Abraham and Sarah's impatience produced much unhappiness for Abraham, for Sarah, for Hagar, and for Ishmael. But maybe we can relate to them. Have you ever been in that place where you're just waiting for God to do something? And in the beginning, your faith is strong, your trust is strong, you give God your problem through prayer, and you have full confidence that God is going to come through you. The time goes by and nothing happens. There's no answer in sight. think, well, you know, maybe God didn't hear me. Maybe I didn't make myself clear. Maybe God forgot. And you continue to try to be patient and faithful, trusting that God will act. But more time passes and still nothing. You're tired of waiting. Your patience has run out. Your faith falters. And you decide that you can take care of this better. And you can certainly take care of this faster than God. So you take matters into your own hands and away from God. And things didn't turn out so well. Things don't turn out the way that you hoped. You see, Ishmael was a product of unbelief. Sarah may have initiated the relationship between Abraham and Hagar, but it was Abraham who cultivated that relationship. This was not in any way the way that God intended to fulfill his promise. Reverend T.D. Jakes comments on Abraham's choice. But those are the kind of decisions we make when we think God's not going to bless us. When we start making arrangements for God because he didn't do what you thought he was going to do when you thought he was going to do. That's pretty much what happened with Abraham and Sarah. They got tired of waiting for God to make good on his promise of many descendants. They were getting older by the minute. It seemed that there was little chance this was ever going to work out. So, they decided that they were going to solve it. Abraham would have an heir through Sarah's maid, Hagar. Yep. That was going to take care of it. What did God want? And what in the world was God waiting for? And then God does keep his promise. And now Sarah has no need and no use for Hagar and for her son Ishmael. Now there's lots of drama here. This almost sounds like some kind of an Israelite soap opera. But it's actually worse. It's unthinkable that Abraham would do this to his son and his son's mother. The hot desert was no place for Hagar and Ishmael, especially without adequate provisions. And when the scanty provisions run out, Hagar could not stand to see her son suffer. She found some shade in the desert and she left Ishmael there to die. And Hagar cries out, "Don't let me watch the child die." And she sat down in the desert and begins to cry. And God hears Hagar's cries for help. Otherwise, this would be a very grim story indeed. Hagar, the Egyptian slave, cried out to God, and God heard. And now God makes a promise to her, too. Listen closely to God's promise, because it has implications for us today. An angel called to Hagar, "What troubles you, Hagar?" The angel sought to comfort her. "Do not be afraid. Lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." And Hagar does as the angel instructs her. And as Hagar dried her tears, God showed her a well where she and her son could draw water. They would not die in the desert after all. God would be with them. And Ishmael would father a people too, just as God had. And now, as the late broadcaster Paul Harvey can say, here's the rest of the story. There's a group of people in the world today who trace their lineage all the way back to Ishmael. God promised Hagar that her son would father a nation. Is God faithful to God's promises? Absolutely. The people who trace their lineage to Ishmael are the followers of Muhammad. They are the Muslims. And they see themselves as heirs to the promise of God, just as the children of Israel, Isaac's son, see themselves as heirs to the promise of God. The 25th chapter of Genesis contains a dramatic footnote to our story. It says that Ishmael's descendants settled near the border of Egypt. And listen to these words from the 18th verse. "And they lived in hostility toward all their brothers." Could it be that consequences of lack of faith and trust in God that happened 2,500 years ago. Could we be paying for Abraham and Sarah's unwillingness to trust God when they used a surrogate mother to bear a son because Sarah was unable to have children? You see, Abraham is the patriarch through which our Bible and the Quran are linked. This passage is relevant to what's been going on in the Mideast almost since the beginning of time. Ongoing fighting over land and war between Jews and Muslims. Isaac was promised an eternal covenant with God to possess the land, while Ishmael was excluded from that covenant. And instead, he was set to live with every man's hand against him. It almost sounds as if the present simmering conflict between Jews and Muslims and Christians and Muslims was anticipated in the Old Testament. You see, Ishmael was the product of impatience. He was the product of lack of faith and lack of trust. Ishmael is the product of mistaken notions that we can shortcut what God wants from us. Too often we convince ourselves that there's a quick fix to get the blessings of God. And there isn't. Answers won't necessarily come overnight, and blessings will not come on our schedule. Rome wasn't built in a day, and any goal worth pursuing will not be achieved right away. But we get impatient and we make mistakes. But you know what? Ishmael is not going to go away. Ishmael is here to stay. The consequences of our choices have a way of hanging around, long after we knew they were wrong. Sarah and Abraham thought they knew better than God, and they didn't trust as they should have. And it was a mistake that has followed their descendants down through the centuries, right up to today. So much that we learn about Abraham is about trust. Why are these old stories of the Bible important to us? Because they are still being lived out today. Problems of trust, issues of faith. Think about that. The next time that you think that you know better than God. The next time that you grow impatient for God's answers to come. It is true. It will always be true. But God always knows best. And God's timing is always good. Let us pray. God, we are so much like Abraham and Sarah. We get tired of waiting. Our faith grows weak. We fail to trust. And we think we know better. And just like Abraham and Sarah, the consequences of our mistakes hang around and visit our descendants for centuries. God, we pray for peace in all of those places where there's conflicts between faiths. And we pray, God, that we might put our faith and our trust in you, that we might be willing to wait upon you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our final hymn this morning is on page 361, Walk Away.
Thank you.
He would receive the benediction this morning. God, we pray that you might help us to be more trusting, that you might strengthen our faith in all of life's trials. God, we pray that we might go from this place as witnesses to the great work that you do in this world. I pray, Lord, that you might go with joy and peace and in the following.